help me welcome Ken Jarrard.
Good morning. Well, that was loud. I tend to be a walker, so forgive me if I tend to pace. I'll stay away from the microphone. They told me if I got near the microphone, it'll cause feedback. So good morning again. It is my pleasure to be in front of you this morning. I will tell you, it is my absolute honor to speak to folks like yourselves who have truly made a commitment to public service. I mean, not only are you talking about public service, you have actually dived in and you have made a commitment by running for, seeking the office that you have run for, and of course been successful in that endeavor. So it's a thrill and honor for me to be in front of you today, and I so appreciate ACCG and Carl Vincent giving me the opportunity to be in front of you. And again, the documentation, the paperwork is the key. That's why government is so concerned not about efficiency. Efficiency is good, but process and accountability and transparency are the key. Two more questions, and then I'm going to have to stop. Yes, sir. The question was, if you're on a board of a charitable institution and you're taking action that benefits that charitable institution, is that something that you should take into consideration? And the answer is yes. I believe that it is something you should take into consideration. Again, you know, if you were to ask me, well, what's the guide? How do we know? And again, I'm not saying that that flat-footed means you have to recuse, because I would need to know what the official action that is being contemplated is. But you always need to think in the back of your head, is my relationship with whatever the business of the county is such, I have a relationship that affects my ability to act impartially and freely in the exercise of my legislative discretion? And if the answer is, you know, I don't. I mean, I am impacted by my affiliation with that nonprofit. I am impacted. I want that nonprofit to succeed. I want them to get this grant. I want them to get this money. Then that's when you need to maybe consult your county attorney and say, should I recuse? Should I disclose and not recuse? What should I do? All right, these are great questions, and I wish that I could answer more of them. I wish I had you for all afternoon, and I don't. But if you come back to some subsequent training, we will do that. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to be in front of you.
I'm sure you'll enjoy our State Attorney General, Sam Olens.
Charlotte's a great lady, so I unabashedly am a big fan of Charlotte. When I was chairman of COPS, she was the county administrator for Gwinnett, and at that time, there probably was not a county that you would want to visit more than Gwinnett for their processes. And of course, I was partial with COPS, but she just did a fantastic job as their administrator. It's great to have her now as their chairman. So 14 years ago, I was in your seat. Unlike some of you 14 years ago, I didn't think I had all the answers. One of the things that concerns me is the folks who get elected who decide because they were elected they know all the answers. And one of the ways I would see that the most is the new commissioners would show up to their first town hall and they'd answer all the questions and you'd have the staff in the room going, oh, blank. So let me suggest to you, first off, admitting to your citizenry that you don't know all the answers is a good thing. It's also honesty. Relying on your professional staff is a good thing. If you find you can't rely on your professional staff, then they shouldn't be there. But until they prove otherwise, listen to them, especially, I might add, your county attorney. So by definition, one of the things, you know, I always used to love that whenever we get new commissioners, the first thing they do is, well, I promised folks, as Ken was talking about, who's an outstanding local government lawyer, your prior speaker, I promised folks I'd introduce ordinances. and you'd say, and you never thought in Cobb County's history we ever thought about that idea and decided it was a real terrible one? Because keep in mind, well, for those commissioners that are elected in a part of their county rather than countywide, what may work in your part may absolutely be terrible in other parts. And even though you're elected by a part, you're there to represent your whole county and to do what's best for your whole county. So it's really important that you walk into the position in January willing to listen. For instance, I had a commissioner that wanted to deal with the size of the lots, and what was good on the west part of my county was absolutely atrocious for the minings part of my county, both unincorporated. And you'd sit there and say, you can't do that. And then they'd say, well, you know, Fulton County, and I'm pretty blunt and pretty candid for the five of you that don't know that in this room. So they'd say, well, Fulton County has specific ordinances for part of their county versus other parts of the county, so didn't that solve the problem? Well, the answer is that's why there's all the damn new cities in Fulton County, because the people felt like they should all be treated the same, rather than little favors given for different parts of the county. So, A, it's a pleasure to be here. We're here to talk about transparency, accountability. Let me suggest to you that that old thing called the golden rule works really well in government. Let me suggest to you that before you press the reply key on an email, take a deep breath and think before you reply.
My name is Cindy Mills with Forsyth County. I have a question concerning the intent of videotaping of meetings. I understand that every citizen has the right to videotape, but do they also have a right to come in before the meeting starts in the reception area and videotape private citizens as they're having conversations? Maybe it's a vendor talking about how they want to present, or maybe it's lots of times it's companies that maybe are strategizing or trying to decide what they're going to present at a work session. And I've just noticed, and it goes up on YouTube, and I just worry.
Oh, I can tell you the lady who does it. I get emails from her twice a week. Okay, so number one, your lawyer's in the room who, as I mentioned, is a really good local government lawyer. It's not like you don't have an office, ma'am. There's no reason why that discussion needs to be happening in the ante room before the meeting. You know, it's really interesting because videotaping was the old law. Videotaping was not markedly changed in the new law. It was permitted then, it's permitted now. What has been done both times is you have to make reasonable accommodation. In other words, you can't put a camera in a room that obstructs the view of others. So, for instance, in Cobb County, we had an area to the side of the room that we would tell anyone with a camera, put your camera right there. Get a great view of the commissioner, see my good side, and film all you want. But you can't be like in the middle where you're blocking other citizens' views of the scenario. You know, the ante room is public. So technically they have the right to have the camera there. You're the one choosing whether to have that kind of a discussion there, and I would suggest maybe the discussion shouldn't occur there. Understood, it's a public space. The question isn't whether I think that's good policy or bad policy, it's a public space. But when the lady from Forsyth says, we have a lady, believe me, I know her name. Because they contact me on a regular basis. I have a little fan club on your issues, you know? Yes?
I'm Lynn Lauder from Whitfield County.
For which county?
Whitfield.
Sure.
And this probably is going to be too basic of a question, but I'm having trouble in my mind between the open meetings and the open records. And open meetings, I understand, is among commissioners and when you could possibly be conducting county business. But we've had a zoning issue already that I've been involved in, and I went and met with both companies and heard what their side of the story was. So are private citizen things public record?
No.
But if I email those private citizens...
Until you're sworn in, it's still private.
Okay, but after I'm sworn in.
Then it's a public document.
Any communication with a private citizen.
Mm-hmm.
But can I go talk to them and that's not public record?
Well, there's nothing to show them in return for the talk. Because it's oral.
So it's all written.
I mean, you'd be amazed how few times people request records like that because they candidly don't want to write the check. And of course, people have the right, I should have mentioned this, people have the right to review the information without paying the 10 cents per page. But I would suggest to you, if you're doing your job right, don't worry about the open records requests. Because unless you're putting stuff in those emails that you shouldn't be putting, if you're encouraging input, if you're asking questions, that's all fine. It's when you start saying, well, my opinion is X, or I'm going to vote X on that issue. That's when you get yourself in trouble, which leads me to the following comment. You know, we used to do town halls, and, you know, like, for instance, there's a picking on Charlotte. I presume there's, you know, numerous divisions of business associations, chamber groups throughout her large county. And, you know, I'd go as the county chair and I'd speak. And I'd look in the meeting and to my surprise, two other commissioners would be there. Well, you know, five-member board, I got three commissioners in the meeting. So what I would say when they'd introduce me, I'd say, welcome to the illegal meeting of the Cobb County Board of Commissioners. And I'd say, I did not know that a majority of the board would be here. A majority of the board is here. It's not right for either of them to be told they need to leave. So these are the ground rules. You're not going to ask me how I'm going to vote on an issue that's coming before the board. And they're not going to answer how they would vote on an issue coming before the board. And I'm your speaker. I'm going to be talking. If they want to make a comment, that's fine. But it doesn't. But it cannot relate to how one is going to vote on an issue before the board, so it overtly does not get us from the gray area to the obvious public meeting area. And I never, and normally when I would do town halls and all, there'd be a member of the local newspaper there, so in Charlotte's case, the Gwinnett Daily, and everyone laughs, and everyone understands that those kind of things happen. But when you sit there and someone says, so I have a concern about, you know, are you going to privatize the airport in Gwinnett County? The answer is, I'm not going to talk to you publicly about that. Because that would be a really stupid thing to do whether there are other commissioners or not. And when there are other commissioners in the room, you're overtly looking for a problem to answer that type of question. And you have the out that from an ethical perspective, under Georgia law, you should not be answering those questions publicly. So always take advantage of the ethical outs you have, which is, you wouldn't want me to say something here that would frankly violate the ethical laws of our state. So if you want to give me information, if you want me to express some concerns I have, that's fine. Don't ask the question in a more direct manner because it hurts the process from a legal perspective. So from your perspective, as long as you're responding to the constituent and you're literally saying, you know, I thank you for your opinion, I have concerns about X and Y, I'd love to get more information on it. If someone wants to send a document request to you, you're not going to get hurt by that. You're going to get hurt if you start showing favoritism to some folks versus other folks, you know, that type of thing. And that's the golden rule again. That's just treating everyone fairly.